Welcome to TV, Tennessee Valley Church. This week, we are at Veterans Memorial Park in downtown Huntsville. This is a fitting monument to warriors. My wife Carrie and I took a bucket list trip with friends this past summer to Scotland and Ireland. The four guys played golf 6 days in a row before our wives came. Then we mainly toured. It was an amazing trip. One reason I've always wanted to go to Ireland is that my family name, Collins, is an Irish name. Before we went, I searched online for the name Collins. Collins comes from O Collian, and I'm sure I'm mispronouncing that. And this is what I found. I'm quoting, O Collian is an ancient Irish name, Collian meaning young warrior. Yep, young warrior. The article went on to talk about the reputation the Collins has had for being fearless and skilled in battle. Having learned all that, I humbly asked my golfing friends to refer to me as young warrior. They kept forgetting to honor my request. One day we went to the Cliffs of Moray, one of the most picturesque and photographed places in all of Ireland. Spectacular fields, cliffs, and water. In the visitor center, there's an interactive screen. Visitors are invited to type their names to see if any family ancestors were from the area. I typed in Collins. Oh yes, the screen told me, there have been lots of Collinses in the region. And by the way, the screen told me, the name Collins means hound. Yes, hound, as in dog. I went from seeing myself as a young warrior to humming Elvis's song, You Ain't Nothing But a Hound Dog. It's interesting how the name someone calls you and what others say about you can shape your opinion of yourself. People in Cairo's prison ministry reported these words from a man they met in prison. People have always called me Mad Dog, the man said. Along the way, I started acting like that name, like Mad Dog. But that's not my real name. I'm not Mad Dog, he said. I'm Keith. Please call me by my true name. Now, what if people had not started calling him Mad Dog? What if he had just been just Keith? Maybe he wouldn't have broken bad. Names people give us, how other people see us, often determine how we see ourselves and how we live. Which brings us to Gideon. It was the 1100s BC. The nation of Israel was weak. Midianite people and others, desert-dwelling raiders, would wait until the Israelite farmers were ready to harvest their crops. Then the raiders would sweep in like locusts over the fields, filling their bellies and the bellies of their beasts on the crops the Israelite farmers had grown, and then destroying the crops that remained. Life was hard for the people of Israel. Helpless to defend themselves, food was in short supply, and morale was low. The people cried to the Lord for mercy. The book of Judges, chapter 6, tells us of a man named Gideon, whom we first meet threshing wheat in a wine press. And everybody knows you don't thresh wheat in a wine press. Wheat was meant to be threshed out in the open on a big flat platform where workers could throw the wheat up with a pitchfork and let the wind blow away the chaff, the useless parts of the plant. This poor guy, Gideon, was down in a wine press, a rather small and confined area hewn out of stone, probably just below the surface of the ground, for the purpose of squeezing juice out of the grapes. Gideon certainly was down in that wine press instead of up on a platform because he was afraid of the raiders I mentioned earlier. A second figure walked up and took a seat where Gideon was working. But this was no regular guy. It was an angel, a messenger from God. And the angel spoke to Gideon, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." Mighty warrior? Is he kidding? Gideon was a wishy-washy wimp with an inferiority complex. and the angel called him a mighty warrior. Then verse 14 begins. The Lord turned to him and said, now first it was an angel of the Lord. Now it's the Lord. This isn't the only time in Scripture we see an appearance by a figure who first looks like an angel but ends up being referred to as God Himself or the Lord. These appearances are called theophanies or appearances of God. Was this visit to Gideon an early appearance of God in the flesh? Maybe. At any rate, the Lord said to Gideon, "Go save Israel from Midian." "How can I save Israel?" Gideon answered. "My branch of the family tree does not produce great men, and I am the least in my whole family, the least of the least, the smallest of the small, the littlest of the little." There's his inferiority complex. "I'm going with you," said the Lord. "You can do this." "Well, I'd like a sign," said Gideon. So Gideon went and made some lamb stew and brought it back, and the Lord touched it with the staff in his hand, and it went up in smoke. Gideon was duly impressed. "Sign me up," he said. Then comes maybe the most exciting verse in the whole story, chapter 6, verse 34. "Then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Gideon." Literally, it says, "clothed himself with." In the Hebrew, it reads, "The Spirit of God clothed himself with Gideon." The Spirit of God put on Gideon like I put on this pullover. This pullover doesn't do anything on its own. It moves only when I move. Gideon was that completely controlled by God's Spirit. Gideon would put out the word, and people gathered from all over Israel to fight the nation's enemies alongside Gideon. Empowered and prompted by God's Spirit, Gideon and his men, 32,000 of them, got organized for battle. But God said something that commanders-in-chief rarely say. "You've got too many men," God explained. "If you whip the Midianites with that many folks, your army will take credit and will not give honor to me." To summarize, God and Gideon whittled down the army until there were only 300 of them, 1% of the original force. So Gideon and his little outnumbered army whipped the enemies of God. Not in hand-to-hand combat, but by shouting, blowing trumpets, and breaking big pots and making such a horrendous racket that the enemy thought they were surrounded and outnumbered, so they retreated. I want to go back to the beginning of the story. Remember what the angel called Gideon? Mighty warrior. At the time, Gideon was a wishy-washy wimp with an inferiority complex. His nation was weak, and Gideon was the least of the least, the smallest of the small, the littlest of the little. He didn't look like a warrior. But the potential lay within him. He had the God-given capacity to be far more than he was. God saw that potential even when others did not, even when Gideon did not. God sees your potential, you know. If God were to send you an angel to visit you, he'd say, "Well, hello, mighty warrior." God sees your potential when others don't, when you don't. When we were kids, we'd say, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but names can never hurt me." We said that to try to convince ourselves, but down deep we were and are hurt by names. It's interesting how the names people call you, the way others see you, can shape your opinion of yourself. Elizabeth Smart was 14 when she was kidnapped by Brian Mitchell. It was late 2002. Brian Mitchell and his wife, Wanda Barzee, did terrible things to Elizabeth, things too horrific to describe here because kids might be watching. One of the things they did to hurt her was to call her by a different name. Her real name, remember, was Elizabeth Smart, but her captors called her Esther or Shir Jashub, an obscure name from the Hebrew scriptures. For 9 months, they kept Elizabeth locked away in an encampment, and they called her by another name. Calling her by another name was part of the torture, the diminishing of her value. On March 12, 2003, Brian Mitchell and Wanda Barzee took Elizabeth Smart, their captive, to a local Walmart. Elizabeth saw a bulletin board where pictures of missing children were posted. Mitchell pulled her away and whispered, "No one remembers or cares about you anymore." Elizabeth wondered if maybe that was true. They had walked two blocks from the Walmart back toward their encampment when suddenly they were surrounded by police cars and police officers. One of the officers pulled Elizabeth away from her captors. "What's your name?" he asked gently. "Are you Elizabeth Smart? Because if you are, your family has missed you so much since you were gone. They want you back. They love you. They want you to come home. What is your name? Are you Elizabeth Smart?" the officer asked. She hadn't been called that for 9 months. Two cruel people had tried to make her think of herself differently, to deny her identity. They tried to control her by calling her someone she is not. She finally got out the words, "I am Elizabeth." She wasn't the false names her captors called her. She wasn't Esther or Shirjashub. Those names made her feel alone and forgotten. She was not what others said she was. No, she was Elizabeth. Elizabeth, the loved, Elizabeth, the precious, Elizabeth, surrounded by family. There is one, an evil one, who will whisper in your ear that you are someone other than who God says you are. He will whisper, "You are the incompetent one. You are the despised one. You are the unworthy one. You are the worthless one." Please know, you are not who that liar says you are. You are who your Father and Creator says you are. And God says, "You are mighty warrior." Some of you don't feel like warriors. Some of you have been bullied and browbeaten. Some of you have been shot down, dragged down, put down, and cut down. You've been beaten up and roughed up, and voices from outside or maybe inside your head are telling you, you don't measure up. Some of you think so little of yourselves. Some of you think, "I'm not good enough to go to church. I don't know enough to go to Bible study." Maybe worse, "I once spent a great deal of effort getting a young woman out of an abusive situation, only to have her return to it that very night. Why did you go back to him?" I asked later. "I don't deserve no better," she told me. Someone listening to me is thinking to yourself, "I don't deserve to be happy. I'm just a loser and I'll never be anything more. God couldn't love me." Not so. Not so. Not so. You are loved. You are of incalculable, immeasurable, inestimable value. You are a prince, a princess, a warrior. When I come back, I'm going to tell you about some real live princess warriors.
When the day is over, those thoughts said, that's when I start to wonder, where do I fit in? But then you remind me that you're holding me tight. Say the past is behind me, it'll be alright. And you say to me, it'll be alright.
Completely.
lost my way, but you found me. Like the rain in the dark on my ugliest days, you say that you'll always love me just the same. And then you remind me that you're holding me tight. You said the past is behind me, and it will be alright. Oh. And you say to me,
better to convince guys who are behind bars that God has a purpose for their life than someone who's been right where they are.
Yes.
This is Keith Williams, and he does the Morgan County Jail Ministry. Keith, yes. Thanks for joining us.
Glad to be here. Glad to be here.
First of all, how did you get off track, and how did God get your attention to let you know he had a purpose for your life?
Well, I grew up in a project, and the neighborhood drugs was coming. So I actually thought everybody done drugs. And I wasn't planning on becoming a drug addict. And what happened was I got married at age 19, made a lot of mistakes. Then I gave up on myself. The crack came out, got addicted to crack, and my life went all the way down. You know, that started me being incarcerated. That started me a life of being homeless, living on the streets. And I just lost who I was as a person.
How did God get your attention and let you know, Keith, I've got a purpose, I've got a ministry for you?
I was in my best friend's yard, and I was contemplating suicide. And I prayed this prayer. I said, God, I can't stop getting high. You know, matter of fact, I like getting high. I mean, I'm an addict at this time. And I said, God, but you told me that you would never leave me nor forsake me. God honored his word, and that day I got delivered. We haven't looked back since.
Well, Travis is talking today about Gideon, and God made him a mighty warrior. And Gideon didn't think he was a mighty warrior. If you go to the jail, how do you convince these guys that God has a purpose for their life?
A lot of men don't know that greatness is always in them. What God gave me was the caterpillar to the butterfly. See, the butterfly is in the caterpillar, but it has to go through a metamorphosis. So I go in and I teach the guys that they're only in a metamorphosis and that greatness is in them. And I'm gonna show you how to get it out by teaching you principles based on transformation. The first principle is forgiving oneself. The second principle is loving oneself. Then the third principle is forgiving and loving others, regardless if they forgive you, because in time, that catches up as you make your transformation, become that beauty for a butterfly.
And I'm sure you've seen good results.
Oh yeah, great results. Short story, real short. God met a guy there, and I won't call his name, but met him in jail, and he ended up now on his own construction company. He came to my house, and he put in sold for me. He had to cut out the cabin and stuff. So I asked him, how much did it cost to pay? He said, $500. So I go to give him the $500, and he said, I can't take it. He said, because when you came in jail, you paid for it, then you have challenged my life. So stories like that is really good and exciting for me to keep me going forward.
And what a ministry. I want to mention that you're also the site coordinator for the Men's Christian Job Corps.
Yes.
And I'm sure that's very meaningful. Thank you so much, T. Thank you for your ministry.
Thank you. Glad to hear.
We're talking about Gideon, an unlikely candidate to be called Mighty Warrior. But God saw his potential, and that is just what God called him, Mighty Warrior. When we lived in Richmond, Virginia, there was a recovery ministry that grew out of our church called North Star. They used to refer to the ladies among them, ladies in recovery from addictions, as Princess Warriors. Princess Warriors. I thought it was silly at first. But these were women who'd been rejected by family members, beaten up by society, abused by men, and shamed by their own bad decisions. Many of the ladies in the recovery ministry saw themselves as not being of great worth. The names they had been called and the names they had called themselves were not good. So in this world of Christian recovery, they reminded each other, "You are a princess, a princess warrior, princess warrior. You are a mighty warrior too, although you might not feel like it, a prince or princess warrior." Maybe it sounds silly, like it did to me at first, but please know, your value is not determined by what others think of you. You are of incalculable, immeasurable, inestimable value, not because I say so, because the Creator of the universe says so. You were created by God to live an extraordinary story, to let someone else's opinion of you and name for you keep you from being who God created you to be. It's not just a shame, it's a sin. So go live extraordinarily. You, yes, you are a mighty warrior.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassion.
Thanks for joining with us today. If you're new to TV Church, my name is Aaron Jackson, and I'm the Minister of Music and Worship at First Baptist Huntsville. We'd like to invite you to one of our two worship services here at 600 Governors Drive. Our contemporary service is at 8:05 a.m. on Sunday, or here in the sanctuary at 10:30 a.m. We'd love for you to connect with others that join you in watching this program every week as well. The best way to make those connections would be for you to go to tvchurch.online. Once there, you can hit the Contact Us button on the left-hand side to start that process. This is also where you can begin to connect with our shared online community, submit prayer requests, watch more episodes, and find other helpful resources. Thanks again for joining us today. God bless you.